congratulations. This is release day, right? This is officially release day after several releases leading up to release day.
Yes. I'm so excited it's finally here.
It must be, I don't know, is it different doing it like this? Because these songs, I guess, have seen their releases in part EPs leading up to it. Does that take away at all from the usual excitement of, and now the album is out?
Hard to say. I mean, it does feel weird because I guess I didn't really think of today as being a very special day. Like you said, we've been releasing these songs as 3-song EPs, but it seems like people are still excited about it. And so I woke up this morning and thought, it's my album's birthday. I'm so excited, and we're having a big party in LA to celebrate, which is great. But I did decide I wanted to try something different with this release. And partially, it was because, you know, I wrote and recorded these songs in January and February following the inauguration and the Women's March, and they were written about a specific time and place, which is America in 2017. So I wanted them to come out as soon as possible, and that's why we decided to do this thing. It's kind of, it's a different era, right? It's a different era. There's so many people are just putting out singles, and are people buying records anymore? I hope so.
The songs are so good, and the album, you know, I mean, as you say, most of these lyrics, I guess, came in one burst, so the songs are definitely held together. I'm getting that anyway, but the whole thing sounds so cohesive anyway. I mean, it does sound like one piece, so to have all the EPs put together, it is really fun and a great way to hear it as a complete piece.
Thank you. I definitely put it together as one big piece. The title track, Be Here Now, was the last song that I wrote in the process. And we got to the end of it and I said, we need a party song. We need a party song. We can't finish this record without a party song. So I definitely see it as telling one whole story. And trying to break it out and put out the songs in sets of 3 was pretty complicated because I felt like I had to tell mini stories each time.
When you're writing a record like this and you know, politically inspired record, there are lots of very specific moments on it. And I mean, how is that for you? How is important or is it at all to try to keep it in broad strokes? A part of me thinks that makes the song have more life. But then again, you know, I can listen to CSNY's Ohio, which is a very specific event. And that's still one of the most powerful rock songs of all time to me. So for you, you know, was it even part of your process to think about, no, I have to keep this in a broad stroke thing instead of being specific, or was it more important to be in that moment for that moment?
I really just try to let each song take on its own voice. And there are songs like Be Here Now, which could be a rally cry for unity in any age, I think, or The Golden Age, which is very specifically about right here, right now in America. And to me, I think they're both valid voices. And I also, I mean, I was reading the news and more than that, reading people's responses to the news when I was in the studio. And I really wanted to try to write from the collective consciousness, not just how I felt about what was going on, but how everybody felt. And so some people were thinking very broadly, sort of like, you know, we should accept refugees from any country, regardless of their religion. And some other people were really affected by politics on a very, very personal level. So I think that came out in the songs just kind of naturally, that sometimes I was speaking broadly and sometimes very, very specifically.
And not to make light of it, but as far as my experience, reading the comments in the news is the quickest way to get depressed about humanity altogether.
Yeah, it is. It is. I gave a TED Talk years back and I laughed. I said, the first rule of being an artist is never read the comments. But I think also the kind of the first rule of wanting to be a human person who has faith for our future is never read the comments.
It's true. With so many issues out there that you could have written about, I mean, was that part overwhelming? Are there ones that you felt more personal to you that you said, well, this is the thing I feel like I can speak most about?
I was honestly following the news every day. I mean, I had some things sort of, I had seeds of ideas, and obviously there are things that I come back to. But the day of the Muslim travel ban and the airport protests, I guess it was actually 2 days, was the day, those were the days that I wrote the song Hold On, which was very specifically sort of speaking to perhaps religious audience who believes that we shouldn't welcome refugees into our country or wants to restrict that. And that to me was just sort of like, where's your humanity? Where's your heart? And the song Witch Wolf, which is, you know, it uses this story as the Native American story about two wolves fighting inside someone, and which one survives. And of course, the answer is the one you feed. And that was when Standing Rock was in the headlines. So I just really was writing in real time to what was happening, to what was in people's hearts and minds. You know, a song like Ashes in the Rain is, I was recording this album in a studio in Nashville with my producer friend that he was going to have to move out of after we finished the record. And so that felt very real, like being inside of this building that's basically going to get burned to the ground. And that felt like a metaphor for America. Like, wow, we were in this space. We thought we knew where we live, but maybe we don't.
Right.
We're going to have to, everything's changing and kind of crumbling around us.
With so many things that happen week to week and sometimes from day to day, what I really appreciate about this record is that it is a reminder. I mean, Standing Rock was something that everyone was so passionate about, was on the front page of everything. And then the moment, you know, everyone thought that there was a victory, it sort of went away, even though, you know, just a month later, it came back like, no, it's not a victory. It's the opposite of a victory. Like, no one was there that, you know, not in the mass numbers that it was that second time, because, you know, everybody had moved on to 10 other things. So now we have to worry about the EPA, and now and all these things that I really do appreciate that about this record, is it is a reminder that a lot of these fights are nowhere near completion.
Yeah, it's like when you have someone who's starting a million tiny brush fires, you're constantly fighting the one that's in front of you, and you forget what the one that was started 10 fires ago has consumed, and you forget that it's still burning. And that's partially why I wanted to make this record, because it was a record of a time that seemed unbelievable. It seemed impossible that that this was America. And it's quite frankly part of the reason why I wanted to put the record out as 3 EPs. I wanted to get it out quickly because I was worried that it was going to change so fast and suddenly it was going to be back to normal and that my songs were going to be irrelevant.
If we could only been so lucky.
Yeah, I know. And I thought, well, wouldn't that be great? And what's really sad to me was, you know, when I put out the Golden Age video a week ago, it was not supposed to come out until today, but after Charlottesville, and we're listening to the president of the United States maybe make excuses for white supremacists in America in 2017, like, I cannot believe that that's the era we live in. I mean, the things that happen every day are more and more unbelievable. Shouting at the Dark was a song that was partially inspired by a lot of my LGBT friends and their fight to keep the rights that they already have, which I didn't think that was going to be something we were going to be talking about in 2017, you know, and then to see the trans ban that has been proposed. So it's just kind of like, wow, this isn't changing, it's actually getting worse. And so what can we do? And, you know, in a song like Golden Age, for me, it was just this utter and total grief for the state of America. Because, right, we can all be angry, we can all be whatever, but at the end of the day, I feel like we're just kind of like grieving this humanity that we've lost. We're divided from our friends, we're divided from our family, we're fighting on Facebook. There's so much anger and tension. And at the heart of it, I really wanted to remind myself about the good in each other, the good in America, which to me is that image of Lady Liberty and everything she stands for, with her, you know, torch in hand through the storms, through the night, just standing strong and standing tall. That's the thing I wanted to remind us of as well.
And there's that moment in Golden Age, which I'll point out, that you get right in the middle of the song, and it goes to that nightmarish minor key thing after musically being a little bit light, even though the lyrics are heavy. And I thought, no, that's what all this has felt like. Like, the music of Golden Age is exactly how this has felt, because there was this moment where we're kind of going along and things are happening, and then suddenly everything just turns into just something that would have been written about in a graphic novel or something. You know?
Yeah, I feel like our storyline these days is so hard to follow. And that, to me, was the same thing as that melody. You know, it's sort of like, wait, where is it going now? But I thought I knew what was happening. Oh, wait, it's changing again. Yeah. That's America, I guess, right now.
Well, it's an important record, and I thank you for this record. And I'll say that it's also really fun to listen to, that if I didn't want to listen to the record, it's still a good record. And I think that's important as well to put out there.
Well, thank you. That's a real challenge, I think. I think some of the greatest protest songs are songs that you don't realize are protest songs. Mm-hmm. I actually just compiled a list of some of my favorite protest songs for another interview, and I put Dancing in the Streets on there. And the interviewer didn't know that that was a song that's considered a big song in the civil rights movement, because it's not about dancing. It's about marching in the streets. You know, when you can get a whole people coming together and singing one song that is changing themselves individually and changing the collective of people, that's power. And so, you know, I think some people might listen to this record and just think it's a dance record, it's dance pop. Well, good. I hope you do. And I hope that maybe you start singing the words and don't realize that what you're singing is just sort of this call for unity and the call to take care of each other and protect each other and take your rage or your sadness and channel it into something worthwhile. And no matter what, like I say in Wild Hearts, you know, just going, never give up.
Beautifully said. Thank you so much. It was really a pleasure talking to you.
Oh, thank you so much. I really appreciate all your support and for taking the time to interview me. You know, you get 4 albums in and you're like, does anybody care? Is anybody listening? I know I'm not the new thing. And God, and now I'm talking about politics. So the last thing you want to talk about is politics. So thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
No, I'm a fan. I'm happy to be a fan too. So, well, take care and we'll see you around.
All right. Take care.
All right. Bye.
Bye.